Hello, everybody. Trying to see who's already logged in and ready for the seminar for today. You guys can ask questions in the Q&A window if you see it. There's a little chat window, so you can also just chat in there. I'd love to know where everybody's chatting from or joining us in from today, which part of town you're from, which part of the country you're from, which other continent or other country you're actually from. Who amongst our mixers, who is, an artist, producer, just throw it all in there. I see a few people coming in. Hey, what's up, guys? Nice. We're pretty much all over the globe. Love it. Nice. So let me just start off with a little background story on how my journey started, where I'm originally from, just for those that are not that familiar with who I am. So my name, of course, is Koen Heldens, born and raised in the Netherlands, come from a small town called Venray. Started in music from an early age on, so my parents put me in music school since about 6 years old till about, the age 12. Hated it because, of course, there's a lot of music theory based in there. Nowadays, I absolutely enjoy that because, of course, music theory helps me a lot with my daily duties as a mixing engineer. And then around age 12, 13, I have two older siblings. My older brother came home with some software that we install on the computer, a little like music composition production software. Started messing around with that. More on the production end. And then by the age of 14, I got my first music publishing deal with 2PSW Music in the Netherlands, which merged into Talpa Music, which is fairly big nowadays. Literally back then, I was already networking. So what I used to do is the internet was more like dial-up still and DSL. So I used to use a fax machine. I don't know who among you guys know what a fax machine is. So I used to send out faxes to record labels, producers, trying to get some collaboration going on and see who would be interested or which labels would be interested in my music. Did that, through that route, I actually got into more of the mixing aspect, because what happened is I got a lot of feedback on my productions about how my mixes were just bad. In other terms, they just sucked. Let's be realistic about it. So I was like, okay, how can I improve my mixes? So for whatever reason, I became very OCD with the mixing element of music. And I started figuring out how to scope sound, basically. Went through high school production, figuring it out, started taking little intern jobs here at a local radio station back home, basically just removing duplicates out of the system, mopping the floors, cleaning the toilets during the weekend. But through that, I learned more of the technology behind everything, the operation of, you know, machinery, EQs, compressors, all those things, mixing consoles, but on a broadcast level. From there on, I got a job basically for a PA company in the Netherlands and started doing some live sound assisting. So I got some hands-on experience with that, but most of the work was like building and, you know, taking basically like, when concerts were done, taking the stages down and all of that. Did it primarily in the weekends. From there on, the owner of that company had a recording studio. So that's how I got more involved with the recording aspect, engineering aspect of music. He had me shadow him and in-house engineer. Did that for, I'd say, about a year or two. From there on, I started doing a study for audio engineering, also in the Netherlands. And through that study, I kind of figured out that I was learning more by practically having hands-on experience with another engineer or just shadowing engineers or producers and seeing what they were doing. So from there on, I applied for a new studio in what was back then in Rotterdam, the Netherlands, called Liquid Spillers. They existed, I think, only for about a year or short of a year. They got one of the very first Neve 88R consoles. Very expensive. They had one of the premier acoustical companies built their studio from scratch in the old Heineken brewery in Rotterdam. So they accepted my resume, and what we went on is they did a little try period and made me in-house engineer. That's when I first got to experience like a real large format mixing console. And the engineer that they brought in as chief engineer came from the US. Through there, at one point, I think, I'm not sure if it was Diddy himself, but I know that some people of Bad Boy Recordings back then were performing either in Amsterdam or in Rotterdam in one of the stadiums, and they needed to record somewhere. So through whatever or however they got there, I don't know, but they found the studio, did a session with them, and through them, I kind of got the invitation for America. So I started working with them slightly, doing some rough mixes, getting records kind of a little bit on point, so they were able to showcase it internally within the label. And from there on, I also started networking more and more, spent some time in the UK, did some work over there, did some work with Harmony Samuels. Not sure if you guys know who that is. It's the producer that, I wouldn't necessarily say discovered Ariana Grande, but he played a big role in her debut album. He's also located in LA nowadays. And start working with him, build up a bigger resume, started getting credits like, being assistant on some records for Lil Wayne, Joel Santana, and kind of built my resume slowly but surely. And at some point I just thought, you know what, let me just go and see what I can do and just pretty much straight up get a working visa and move to LA. And I was about 18, 19 years old when I made the leap of faith, went over to LA, hustled, networked. As many know, that is the industry is very, very small. So the more you network, the more you put in hours, the more, you do favors. Of course, you start out with doing a lot of free mixes just to showcase your capability, your talent. And through that, you slowly build more of a rapport with producers and labels. So your name will be out there. And before you know, you start working actual sessions, be it as a recording engineer, as a mixer. So I grew from there. And at some point, I got blessed enough through two managers, Big Rick and Cheryl Banks, who managed Timbaland, to get them to manage me. I think I was under management with them for about 3 years. Did some work with them, but what I started noticing is that I was located on the West Coast and they were located on the East Side. So it's very difficult to work in-house with people when both are on two different sides of the United States, basically. So it didn't really pan out as we thought it would be on paper. So we parted ways. I was like, let me figure this out. I need to find a situation that actually will keep me pretty much busy and will allow me to have challenges and develop myself more as a mixer. So at some point I rented a studio in LA, and in that same building, there was another producer who was in-house with Dr. Dre. His name is Dem Joints, and basically knocked on his door when I figured out he was there to figure out which studio he had in the building, and basically told him, hey, I'm a mixer. Would love to work with you, love your music. If you have anything that needs mixing, just shoot it my way so you can try me out and I'll just completely do it for free. He showed me a couple of records my way, mixed them. He loved it, started working with him, and slowly but surely started working with the whole Dr. Dre camp. Through that experience, I learned a lot of my mixing better because I used to be extremely technical. So it was always pretty much by the book, like, you cannot do this or you cannot do that. And through the experience of really getting to learn the feel with that whole camp, where it's like, throw all the rules out of the window and just listen to the record and go by feel, go by intuition and go by feel. Because not everything that looks wrong is wrong. if it sounds good, it's good. So I took that approach and my mixes instantly became much more, I would say just better. They improved, and it also improved the clients that I worked with and the actual music that I was working on. So throwing all the technical stuff out of the window basically and just purely moved by feel. From that situation, I was kind of like, okay, I need bigger challenges. I need to go on, you know, I need to step out again and go on my own. And through that situation, I started working with a producer, and that producer of Jamaican descent was working with Sizzla. I don't know how many of you know Sizzla, the reggae artist. So I was like, this is a great challenge. I'm up for it. That is all exactly. Did all of the I'm Yours album for Sizzla. It's, I think, still to date his highest charting reggae album in the United States. And through the producer that was working with Sizzla, I got introduced to XXXTentacion. So at first he pitched me, so as we call him Ja, because of Jase, he pitched me Ja, and he said, hey, there's this kid. He's from my part of town in Florida, and I think he's the next one to blow. I want you to work with him. He wants to work with you. And I was like, I'm not sure, because he was like, he's a SoundCloud rapper. So I was not really familiar with the whole SoundCloud situation. Just knew like it was a platform like we had back in the day called mp3.com, where everybody used to upload their records. And I was like, I'm not really interested in, you know, spending time or putting time into a SoundCloud rapper, because I don't think the SoundCloud thing is going anywhere. Who knows, I was completely wrong with that. But what happened is, because Jase started pushing him to like keep telling him more about him, the producer. So eventually I was like, okay, play me a song that needs to get mixed from him, and I'll see if I'm interested in mixing the song. So he played me Jocelyn Flores. And I was like, there's no way that's him. By the look of how he looked and then hearing the music, one or two didn't match up for me as the bias that you create in your head. Didn't know much about him, didn't even know that he was the rapper behind Look At Me. So the interesting part was that to me, it was completely new territory. And working with that, I was like, you know what? I love the persistency, because I remembered how I, in my teenage year, was as persistent as he was with pushing yourself and, you know, showcasing people like, yo, this is my music, listen to it. I hope you, you know, you mess with it, you like it. So as soon as I heard Jocelyn Flores, I was like, yo, this is incredible. I love this. This is completely not what I expect, but, you know, the music was just incredible. So I told him, okay, cool. Send me the session. I'll mix it for free. Because at the end of the day, you know, you're still in a way starting out. I don't want you to like spend money on a mix not knowing if this is going to go anywhere. So mix the record. He loved the record. I think I either did it in one straight mix pass, or we did a few minor tweaks on it. And then he told me, oh, I got this other record. Excuse my French, but this is the actual title, called Fuck Love, with a rapper named Trippie Redd. So I heard that and I was like, this is dope too. Send it my way too, since that's another single. Did a mix of that one as well. And then the cool thing was that I didn't remember his artist name anymore, put it that way. So I think it was beginning of September 2017, and my phone rang, got some text messages in, people were congratulating me, and I was like, what are you congratulating me on? Producer gave me a call, he's like, do you still have your session drive that has all the sessions on there from the end of July 2017? I'm like, of course. I keep all my drives, keep things backed up multiple times. So yeah, and he's like, just go to the through your folder and look for an artist that starts with XXX. So it's like, can't find anything. Then he's like, okay, look for a session that says Jocelyn Flores. Typed it in, pulled up, and I was like, oh wow, I totally forgot I mixed that record. And at that point, the record was charting. The album was out and the album was charting. It was actually number two on the Billboard 200 chart. And it was number one on the R&B chart. And I was like, this is insane. This is great. This is amazing. So that's kind of the connection I got with X. Some time passes by, and I remember it was November of 2017. Giants me up, and he's like, yo, I'm doing this project with Ronnie J. I'd love for you to mix the whole thing. And the way we were always worked pretty quick. So it would be like, as soon as Jai would have recorded the song, he would send the whole session my way. I'd do a mix same day, would send a dry back to him. He'll listen to it. He'll give me some pointers on, you know, what kind of tweaks he wanted to have. And basically that will be it. So November comes, we started working on a Get a Christmas Carol EP. And the funny part is, and I will never forget this because this gave me such a different approach to mixing again. I remember trying to hit up Ronnie and was explaining to Ronnie, hey, your 808s are distorted beyond anything. Probably you're distorting them through, because he's working in Logic, through the mix bus. So could you lower the fader to make sure that the 808 is not distorting? And Ronnie hits me back and he's like, the whole purpose of the 808 is not to sound clean. It needs to sound like pretty much like the electric guitar for rock music. So it needs to have that, it needs to rattle the trunk, but it also kind of needs to play like that second lead. And here I am trying to clean up a distorted 808, or at least try to figure out how I can make it sound cleaner. So I was like, my approach is completely wrong. I have to switch it over and go the opposite direction. I need to make it more dirty or more lo-fi. And at the same time, as I was thinking that, I was like, we're about to put out a project and I'm going to sound like the worst mixer on the planet. Which then again made me realize it's not about me as a mixer. This is all about serving the client, serving the art, serving the music, serving the artist. So it opened up my eyes more to like, okay, let's figure out what this song is and how to go from here versus I'm a mixer. I have to push my ego onto the record and it has to sound a certain way as, you know, like it has to sound as the greatest song ever mixed wise. But again, nobody's going to listen to a record when it comes on the radio, when you stream it on Spotify and be like, this sounds crisp. I wonder who the mixer is. At least majority of the consumers won't do that. So it's like, okay, we need to make a statement with the song and it needs to serve the song. So did that, put out the Get a Christmas Carol EP, no promotion, no nothing. Jai just put it on the internet on SoundCloud and it charted, I think, number 34 on the independent album charts without any promo. So that was amazing too. And then January of 2018 came around and Jai hit me up. He's like, hey, I'm starting my new album. I got this record and I believe it's a number one record. And I was like, cool. I'm like, send the session over and send me the riff mix so I can, you know, start mixing it. He's like, I need it back in like an hour. I'm like, yeah, it's not going to happen. It's going to take a few more hours, but send it to me. You got it back as soon as possible today. Send me over and the record was set. And the funny part was I was always somewhat challenging Ja on what he would say in regards to the music, but I was always wrong because he was always, you know, it's the number one record. I'm like, nah, I don't think it's ever going to be number one record. And we now know that it has a Guinness Book of World Record for most streamed song in 24 hours on Spotify. It still holds it, I believe, for a male artist. Did said, I think I mixed that in about 4 hours. Came back, we did a few tweaks. Jazz frequent collaborator, John Cunningham, produced that song. Lobus Productions, always simple, but very, very quality. And that's another lesson I think a lot of producers need to know, that you don't need 20 million sounds in a record to make a good record or to make a big record. Simplicity is key. And I've always liked simplicity. And I've seen that, I mean, I've had sessions too where you got like 10 kick drums, 12 snare drums, a bunch of layered synthesizers and basses. And then what I usually do is I'll press play, listen to the riff, and then I go through the kick drums and the snare samples and just listen. And 9 out of 10 times, I can pick one kick drum and one snare drum out of it and literally through some sculpting create the exact same and usually an improved version of the quote-unquote kick drum or snare drum that they have in their session. And through that, you start learning, okay, I just have to pick the right sound instead of choosing sounds, multiple sounds to kind of mimic what you might have in your head as that perfect sound, sample, kick, snare for the record. So long story short on that. So that was my journey pretty much with Ja. And then I remember when it was about May, I think mid-May, I had changed my number. Ja always used to change his number 20 million times. So there's no way I had his number anymore. So he DM'd me and he's like, hey brother, what is your new number? Hit him up. He FaceTimed me a little, like, I think within less than a minute. So I was like, well, I'm like, okay. And he was like, hey, I'm working on skins. It's almost done. Let's do this again. Let's, you know, start working on it and push it. He wanted to do something completely different from what he had done before. So we started working on that. Always an amazing experience. And that's pretty much my journey with Ja. What I'd like to do now is, unless there are other questions in regards to career-wise, I'd like to jump in and showcase a little bit about one of the sessions, the new single that's out, School Shooters. I'm not sure if anybody has already seen the music video. The music video is, in my opinion, amazing. It's like a little movie. To me, it completely is what Ja would have done vision-wise for the video as well. The record, of course, on his latest album, Bad Vibes Forever. I'm not sure how many of you guys have already listened to that album or purchased it. Cool thing with this record is it was actually done during the same time as Question Mark. And the argument, so to speak, was, or the dialogue, was the school shooting occurred in Parkland. And Ja wanted to do something back for them, as he always wanted to do for basically the world at all times, is give back help and support. And it was between Hope and it was between School Shooters. And the issue was which one he was going to go with, and eventually decided that he wanted to keep School Shooter and wait until his name was a bit bigger so he could get bigger features, and he would love to have Lil Wayne on there. And I'm really glad for the team, for his mom, for Solomon, to make that happen, to realize his vision and his dream to get Lil Wayne on there. So we got that record, and I'm going to showcase you a little bit. I'm going to play a little bit of that record, and I'm going to guide you through kind of how I mixed it. And I can tell you that by one of the plugins that was just released, show you that in a minute, that I did the mix in July of 2019. So let me pull up the screen, share it with you guys. Here we are. I hope everybody can see this. So what I'm going to do real quick, let me close that window, is play a little bit and then I'll guide you through the session. And as you can see, it's a very small session. Again, less is more. I'll just give a little playback. And let me double check. This should be working. So that last time. For some reason, it's not playing now. Try this again. Small technical difficulty, guys. Let me switch it back. So in the meantime, if there's any questions. Somebody, Joshua, asked me if there's a different approach that I had in mixing Access Music versus other people. And indeed I did. Because again, what I love to do is I always like to work with artists and then kind of figure out what their sound is. So every artist has their unique sound versus, you know, just mixing every song as you mixed the song before. So yeah, that was always something, as he would call the formula, that we would work on and refine and get better that way. Let's see if we got audio back. There we are.
Yeah.
So first thing that I need to address is, as you can hear Ja clearing his throat. He always would love to keep that in his song. And I know from fans that they always loved when they heard Ja clearing his throat, because they knew that something, you know, great was coming up. So I always kept it in there. I never cleaned it up on any of the songs that I was blessed enough to work with him. Imagine for the school, shoot it, slit the list, girls get fucked up. Hangers, that's for flag poles, with sad souls, the innocent. Who the fuck's protecting us? Well, you better buckle up, cause I got questions for you. I've had enough. Triple X, size, Bible, triple X. A school shooter, I just need attention, yeah. Tell the principal, I ain't got no principles. I don't need no school, I got internet, yeah. Kids at school calling me different, yeah. So I'm trying to work on my differences, yeah. Cool kids at school. So Wayne's verse already has, and I will solo it. It already had some effects on there. Triple X, size, Bible, triple X. A school shooter, I just need attention, yeah. Tell the principal, I ain't got. So a lot of times what happens with features is that the artist has a certain sound for his vocals, his or her vocals, and their primary recording engineer usually will send them your way with majority of the processing already on there. That does not mean that you don't have an option to contact the recording engineer or the artist manager and be like, hey, could I get the vocal dry? But I always like to, like I said before, make sure that the artist stays the way they envision themselves. So in this case, Wayne's vocal is already wet with the delays, reverbs, some compression. I refined it a little bit more to make it fit within the actual record. And there's not much that I'm doing on the vocal. What you can see here is a plugin called Lo-Fi. It's Avid is the only one that makes them, but you have different versions of this plugin in other DAWs. What I'm basically doing is I'm setting the bitrate is slightly back. What happens with this is the vocal becomes how I like to say it, more like a little bit more in the pocket, because more of that high-end sheen gets kind of like rounded off, which the thing with digital is that digital sounds clean, and to our ears we're not used to hearing clean perfect sound, so the ear always wants some coloration to it, and this is a nice way to kind of round off the vocals. As you can see, I give it a little bit of distortion. Again, distortion brings sounds more to the forefront. Don't overdo it, listen to it. It's like seasoning. If you're cooking and you throw a little bit of seasoning in your food, that's what you do with distortion. You give it a little bit of a flavor. After that, I am using, and this is what I was mentioning earlier, the Focusrite console plugin. I remember this just got released and they gave it to me and I played around with it. And this happens quite a bit. If I'm working with, you know, on any song, and I'm a big fan of Plugin Alliance, not to overly sell you guys on it. And this plugin came out, they sent it to me and I was like, hey, I'm working on this session. Let me just try it on there. Kind of got fun to it, because what I like to do with folks, although I like to give them a little bit of a color, I still like to keep them pretty clean as possible, which when I get to the instrumental part of the song, it's completely the other way around. So as you can see, I'm doing a little bit of compression on Wayne's vocal. I'm just adding it in a little bit to kind of make him more compact and sustainable in the song without too many of the vocal volumes jumping around. And I'm using a sidechain, internal sidechain. So as you can see on the high pass filter, I'm having it all the way to 240 hertz. The reason why I do that is that I don't want any of the low end of the vocal to trigger the compressor to kick in too hard. Because we all know that if, for instance, one of the plosive words comes in and the internal sidechain is not engaged, it can trigger the compressor, meaning it will all of a sudden compress heavily, and before you know, your vocal can just fall in volume by 3 to 6 dBs, which is very audible, and then jump back up depending on what your release time is set on, you know, your compressor. So I always make sure that I use a filter for that. Then the cool thing is that this compressor has, and other compressors have it as well, like the Imperial Labs Distressor, is I can actually do a bell curve. So I can actually accentuate a frequency which you have here, set to 600 hertz, but I'm doing it exponential times 10, so it's 6 kilohertz. And it overly starts responding because it's parallel. It starts boosting the 6 kilohertz range, which is, in this case, was very brittle and sharp on Lil Wayne's vocals. So the compressor starts overreacting to that bell curve. It's not audible because it's not in the audible part of the compressor, but the compressor reacts to it because it's sidechained. So what happens now is your harnish of that vocal gets compressed a little bit more, but it's more neutral and more transparent than if you were to like use any compressor and start either overall compressing the vocal with a wideband. This helps, you know, eliminate certain frequencies without having the compressor react overall and get the same issues that you have, for instance, with the low end. The other thing I did with the vocals is I shelved off a little bit around 330 hertz. The reason for that is that I don't want any of the plosives and the harmonic series. So, you know, let's say you have a plosive at 200, so 400 is the next one, 800 is the next one, and so forth. I want to kind of roll that off so that it's easier on the ear. You don't have that much low end bumping in the muddiness, so to speak, of the vocal. Add a little bit of 1200, as you can see here, because again, I have the times three enabled, which is the yellow one. So 1200, did a little bit on there. Reason why I put in 1200 is, and I'll audition it, I'll play it on Wayne's part, and then you can hear, I'll solo, on vocal still solo, good. You'll hear that the vocal become more front when I dial it in more. And when I dial it back, you can hear that kind of the vocal slightly falls back.
Triple X, that's Papa Triple X. A school shooter, I just need attention, yeah. Tell the principal I ain't got no principles. I don't need no school, I got internet, yeah. Kids at school calling me different, right, yeah. So I'm trying to work on my differences, yeah. Cool kids at school smoke bigger risks. Teens with nicotine or with...
So as you can hear, the vocal becomes more front. I experiment with that a lot of times. Sometimes the vocal needs it, sometimes it doesn't need it. It also depends on the music you're working with. I added a little bit of 4.52. I think that's basically because the vocal is a little bit dull without it. And then of course some high end. I always add high end to majority of the material. Because one thing I've learned from another mixer, Dave Monsanto, is that your vocals need to sound expensive. So you start focusing on the high end without making it too brittle. But where the real money is the low end. So now having explained that I rolled off a little bit of with a shelf of the low end of the vocal, there's always a parallel. I like to use the 1176 Blue. In this case, it's a plugin from Universal Audio. And what I do with that is I compress the vocal very heavy because it's a parallel chain. And I add a bunch of low end back in. And this is where the trick comes in. Because I just rolled off with a shelf some of the low end on the vocal, now with compressing that vocal parallel very solidly, there's no jumps in volume, no jumps whenever there's a plosive word coming in. I can add that low end back in. And adding low end means that you can lift elements in the mix. And I'll show you that in a minute as well with the drum section. So while I have this on solo, what I'm going to do is I will take the parallel out and bring it back in. So this is with it.
Triple X, that's Papa Triple X. A school shooter, I just need attention, yeah. Tell the principal, I ain't got no principles, I don't need...
That's without it.
Triple X, that's Papa Triple X. A school shooter, I just need attention, yeah. Tell the principal, I ain't got no principles, I don't need no school, I got internet, yeah.
You can hear the vocal comes forward. What I'm going to do is I'm going to bring the fader in a little bit more, so I'll add in some more volume. That way you can clearly, more clear hear what happens with that parallel chain.
Triple X, that's Papa Triple X. A school shooter, I just need attention, yeah. Tell the principal, I ain't got no principles. I don't need no school, I got internet, yeah. Kids at school calling me different, right, yeah. So I'm trying to work on my differences, yeah. Cool.
So as you can hear with a parallel, the beautiful thing is you can completely lift elements out of the mix, because if I were to do this on the vocal itself, already I expressed that the plosives of the words will become too much. She will hear too much low end muddiness coming through the mix. And in this way, because it's rolled off with a shelf on the main vocal and I send a parallel signal do that to another compressor, compress it completely down to one solid piece of information, I should say, and add the low end back in, as you can see here, a lot of 150 hertz. You can hear that I can lift the vocal in the mix without changing the overall sonic tone of the vocal, because that's another thing. You don't want to change the actual sound of something that you're working with. This is another thing, the drums. I'll go to that too and show you how I usually do stuff and why I use parallel on there. So the cool thing is, and let me solo basically just the instrumental. Take the vocal out. So I remember one thing with the 808, with the rough that we had, and I remember I had distinctively had to listen to it because there was such a buzzing sound on that 808. And usually I don't bring that much high end into an 808, but if you listen to the 808. Hear how thin it is without simple EQ. But then when I brought out the high end on that 808, you can hear how the buzz tone works. And then within the drums, it works as a some sort of like a driving force, which is really cool. Again, I love parallel a lot. So what I did with the bass too is I added in some distortion. You can hear when I take it out, the 808 becomes a little bit thin. Now there's different ways. This is a great one. It's technically an Ibanez TS-808 distortion. It's a distortion pedal used a lot by bass guitar players. It's a great one that works. The other one is the Ampeg. I'll pull that one up as well. Universal Audio makes one. Softube makes one, to name some manufacturers, and Plugin Alliance makes one. For the sake of just showcasing it, let me quickly take a preset out of this one. Let's see what make a good one. Let's say Dark Lows. Can hear it. It's because of this distortion you give, and because of, as you can see here, the EQ on the bass amp, you can dial in a lot more information in certain frequency areas and blend that with the original sound without changing the actual overall sound of a of an instrument. And that's the same way I do with drums too. So it's very important in this song to keep the bass and the kick together, because I'll play it without the bass and you hear how tiny the kick is, but together it kind of functions as a nice kick drum bass collaborative effort, so to speak. See how nice they glue together. This might be something interesting for those. I know a lot of you guys have a lot of plugins, use a lot of plugins. There's been so many manufacturers that are using SSL plugins. I love this one. I've audited them, pretty much all of them, auditioned all of them. And one thing I learned during the Dre days is the SSL brown knob EQ. It is the least popular among most engineers. Most engineers are used to the black knob, the 242, but the original 02, which is the brown knob, is basically the Q of the EQs are wider than the black knob, and you can't boost as much than the black knob. I think brown knob goes till about 15 dB, while the black knob goes to 18 degrees, so you can get some more out of it. The black knobs are a little tighter in Q2, but also the black knobs have less capacitors in there than the brown knob, which means that there's a lot more coloration going on in the brown knob. The cool thing with the brown knob is that the sound sounds more like, you know, like a baseball hitting really hard. So it works great for drums and bass. You can hear it too quickly whenever you have the chance and you can play around with them. I think the universal audio enables you or allows you to go between two modes. And I know the Brainworks one does it. I'm not 100% sure if the Waves one does it. I know that Plugin Alliance just came out also with the 9000 one. SoftTube has had one with the 9000. Nice little thing to know is that SAT was mixed with a console one from SoftTube with the 9000 channel strip. I've had experience with the real consoles, brown knob, black knob, 4000, 9000, 8000. And what I can say is that the 9000 was great for its time because Pro Tools was very limited still on a lot of the plugins. So a lot of stuff had to still happen on the board. And what happened is that the computer in the 9000 was amazing. You could quickly do the automation, recalls, all of that. The workflow was amazing versus the 4000, which of course is a 1980s console. But the 4000 has such a great coloration, and the whole purpose back in the day was to make analog sound as clean as possible, until we figured out with digital that digital was not something our ears are used to or want to hear. Just, it doesn't sound good to sound, have things sounding that clean. We need that quote unquote distortion, the non-linearities as they call it. So I've always had a love for the brown knob, will continue to have it. And that's what I always use on my drums. So I can showcase it with the kick. And what I'm gonna do is I'm keep it on brown and I will turn it up a little bit more and then I will switch it to the black knob so you can kind of hear the slight differences in the sound of the EQ. Let's see. As you can hear with the brown knob, the kick drum comes forward a bit more than the black knob. It's subtle, but it's almost like it gives that low mid like a real chest boost, if that makes sense. It's almost like the brown knob did more push-ups than the black knob, if we say in those terms. I always parallel the kick too, and what I do is simply, it's a trick that Bob Powers originally did on A Tribe Called Quest. And I learned this trick throughout the years through a good friend of mine, Dave Pensado. And we used to use back in the day the hardware version of the DBX. We always used to call this 160 the VU. And the other one, it was the XT. Not much of a difference. It's just that this one has a VU meter. The other one had a PPI meter with the lights in the rack. So what I'm going to do is, it's the same thing as with the vocals. So you have the kick with it. Now I'm going to bypass it. So you can hear it comes a bit more forward. So the beautiful thing is with parallel, like I said before, I can add an extensive amount of information on the parallel scent that I'm doing versus adding that much on the kick drum. Because for instance, if I were to add it only on the kick drum, you're going to hear that the kick drum is going to change sonically. It's going to change completely. See how it becomes different? See how the kick drum sound changes? We don't want to do that. That's why we use parallel chains. So we just create a send it to an auxiliary track, in this case, right below it. I call it the pull tag. I use an equal sign, so that way with one view on the session, I know that's a parallel. And the triangle sign, so to speak, I use as like, that's my summing. So I know that's a summing buzz. So barrel on the kick drum. I always add distortion on there too. Can do it with different things. I'll bring this one up a little bit more in volume too, so you can hear what it adds to the kick drum. It's basically, I use this distortion to bring the kick out more of the mix. So it gives you those upper harmonics, which then again, make your kicks audible on devices like an iPhone, your laptop speakers, anything that you want to have the kick, you know, be playable on, because a lot of people just listen in small earbuds, listen through their phone. That's all what we need to have. Same with snare. So with the snare, I do the same thing. Like I said, I love the brown OBQ. Always add a little bit of high end on my drums. This case, it's by feel. So let me play it and then kind of play with the control, so you can kind of hear like, okay, now the snare becomes more apparent. Now it's not really adding anything to the signal. So we need the low end, because without the low end, it becomes less solid in the mix. I like the blue low mid band, because it's in my opinion, it's the dirty band of these two. You can see it's subtle, but it brings the clap more forward in the mix. Same with 3K. So it's always a debate with me with drums, whether I want to focus on the lower region of the 1 to 3K, if I want to go close to the 1, or do I want to have closer to the 3, maybe I want to have both of them just to push it more forward, because our hearing is most sensitive between 1 kilohertz and 3 kilohertz, so a lot of information needs to be conveyed down there. And that's without EQ. With EQ, as you can hear, it's very subtle, but it improves the sound, and that's always what needs to happen with, you know, anything you work with. Does it improve the sound, or does it take away from the sound? And not always does the sound need any treatment. I do always focus heavily on the drums, and same with the parallel. I do the same thing on the snare. As you can see here, the only difference is I like to use a API 550A. So without. It's with. As you can hear, it pushes it more forward. So it's the same thing that I did with the kick drum, with the vocal, add some low end in there, I added some mid-range in there, so it makes it, you know, pierce through the music more and more on your speakers. Removed a little bit of high end because I didn't want to have too much of a bright like clap happening. Same thing, you compress it, you EQ it afterwards. And then the keys, I did little bits on keys. The thing that I always love to do just on synths in general, especially if there's only low-end information and mid-high information, because you have like the drums and then the drums and the bass, and you have the vocals sitting there, but not really anything in the low mids that kind of, you know, gives the warmth and drive the song. You do have it in this. So I usually add a little bit of the low mids in there, which I did around 330. As you can hear, it brings the warmth back into the song, pushes it a little bit forward. Without. With. So it's little EQ moves that can improve and help certain elements stand out more in the music. I hope I've showcased some good information on the session itself. Since we're approaching the last 10 minutes, I'd like to see what kind of questions you guys have left in the Q&A, so I can see what you guys love to do. How do you go about stereo imaging your drums, melodies, vocals, etc.? Well, That's what Isaiah asked me. So usually what happens is I get the session in. As you can see, I always ask for stems. The reason why I ask for stems is that I want to minimize the technical issues I might run in or my assistant might run into with opening a Pro Tools session, and there might be plugins missing, or every once in a while a plugin acts up and doesn't work really well. So you have to, like, you know, figure out to get that working again. There are certain routings that have been done. There's certain things that have been added to the sound that needs to sound as one sound. So I always ask the producer, like, hey, send me the mix as you have it in printed stems, and I'll build from there, because I don't want to reinvent the wheel and for us to do one or two steps backwards to then lose a lot of time to get back to square one and move from there. So it's you know, it's a thing that helps us save a lot of time. As far as imaging goes, in that case, folks are usually delivered the way they are, drums are delivered the way they are. There's not much that I really do with it, unless I feel that a sound is really in the way of another one. Let's say they both are fighting for the same space. I might slightly use a pen to the left or the right to kind of open up that space more. I do have an imager on my master bus, which this is the famous preset that Dave Pensado and Jason Joshua already always talk about. I've gotten this from Dave in Ozone 4, but adapted it all the way to Ozone 8 in this case, or 9, I think this is. So literally what I do is there's only one band that's widened. So I widened everything between 300 and 2.5K, meaning that the warmth, as we perceive in records, is pushed. So if I play the record and take it out and bring it back in, you can kind of hear what it does. So as you can hear, is that as soon as I take it out, the imaging on that low mid, that the bass and the synth fall back into like more of a center image. And as soon as I enable it, you can hear the warmth and the whiteness of the mix happening. I never do anything with the low end. I usually like to keep it mono as much as I can. Same with the high end. Every once in a while, you have some background vocals or ad-libs that could use a little bit of, you know, imaging on the high end so that they spread out a little bit nicer. But 9 out of 10 times, this is the only imaging I really do. Let's see what the other questions are. There's another good question about low end, how I keep my low end in control between 20 and 40 hertz. In essence, I don't really do anything about it. I always have the filters. Well, usually I have filters engaged, in this case not, but usually they're engaged automatically on a plugin like this. So already with anything below 16 hertz gets cut off. I know with the brown knob, it's a 6 dB per octave. I think the black knob is 12 or 18 dB per octave, so it's much steeper. And then the same in my pre-mastering, because what happens is I never deliver a mix with my maximizer on. So I always take this off and I send it to mastering and make sure it doesn't clip. But I have an equalizer on, and as you can see, anything pretty much below 40 hertz, I just scoped off because I don't want that information. And a lot of times, you know, you don't hear that information on most speakers that we play on anyway. And it's just, it's mud, it's rumble. Also the thing with low end in essence is basically bass. If we look at it, it's volume. There's not much you can do, because even on the bass, I'm pushing 63 hertz. But in essence, what I could have also done is just push up the fader. So if you want more bass, push up the fader. If you want to have less bass, turn down the fader. That's a general approach with low end, for that matter. Kevin asks, what's your process when it comes to gain staging? So gain staging, I know, for instance, if you see the numbers here, that I need to bring in my drums at -7, but that comes because the way I mix into my sub bus processing for drums and for mixing. So for mixing, my group is already done and I mix into it. The reason why I do that is because I want to know what happens to my sound when I'm mixing versus having the mix done and then, you know, pushing a compressor on there or a distortion plugin or whatever, and then all of a sudden you mix collapses because, you know, you didn't know how it sounded with that on. And that's the same way why I have mastering on there, like a limiter, and I usually have two limiters, push it into another limiter just to give like a reference version to the client, but at the same time knowing on my end how it will sound when it goes through mastering, when it gets serviced to the radio, so you know how much beating basically your mix can take, if that makes sense. Let's see what the other questions are. Hope you guys are enjoying this so far and it's not too too nerdy. Okay, somebody asked how I can keep my vocals on top of the mix. Basically, it's a volume thing. So I know that at the end of the day, what I do is, what everybody can do is on the volume knob on your, either your audio interface or if you have a monitor controller, what you do is you turn it all the way down until you barely can hear the music playing. Listen to it and see if you can clearly hear the vocals. If you can't clearly hear the vocals, turn them up a slight bit until you can hear them audible. And then usually when you do that, turn it down a slight bit after that, and that's usually the ballpark figure of where you need to be in. Guys, please, if you have questions, put it in the Q&A box instead of the chat. Laura asks what's better as far as DAWs goes. There's not really anything that's better. It just comes down to what you're most comfortable with. I grew up with Pro Tools because it was the industry standard, so that's why I'm in Pro Tools. But everybody has different, they like different software. Some people are Logic because it works better, others are in Cubase, others are in FL Studio. It all comes down to what works for you. So there's not any rule or anything that is better. Joshua asked, what's my advice on artists that want to start producing and mixing for the first time? Basically, just do it. Just straight up, just do it. It's all about logging hours and make sure you listen to music, listen to auto music, so you can kind of train your ear and figure out like, oh, this is how that sounds, this is how that sounds, and just play around. It's all about logging hours and hours. Because in essence, I would say even us as professional mixers technically don't know what we're doing. We're just listening to the music and going with the vibe, going with, you know, what we're hearing, with feel, and just figure out, does this improve the sound or does this take away from the sound? If it doesn't improve from the sound, just leave it. Let's see what other questions we have. If I don't use de-essers, Mario asks, I use de-essers. In this case, I like the SPL de-esser. The reason why I love SPL de-esser is it's not a traditional one. So this one basically uses phase inversion. So what that does is it switches the sound in parallel 90 degrees. So what happens is if you put it back in and it only focuses on the sibilance of a vocal, it pushes it back in, and by the amount you put back in, you reduce on the actual audible audio, the S versus actual compression. Because with actual sidechain compression with a regular de-esser, you usually start hearing some sort of the compression artifacts. So that's why I love to use the SPL de-esser. So I do use de-esser, but I only use them when indeed I feel like the sibilance on a vocal is too much. Sometimes I get vocals delivered and they're recorded and they're perfect. Like for instance, with jazz vocals, there's no de-esser on there because, you know, it's just great recording and there's no need for that. It just sounds right. And also realize that sibilance is how we recognize speech. So do not overdo it, because then it will start sounding like somebody has a lisp and it becomes less audible. Dan asks another great question. Has loudness normalization across different streaming platforms changed how you approach mixing at all? And what are your opinions on analog summing in a mix? I don't like analog summing. We've done shootouts with a couple of pretty known mixers a couple years back. And the thing was that we didn't really hear any difference. The same that we had mixes done in the box and on the console, where, you know, it's in my opinion, it doesn't matter. There's another mixer out there, Servant Genia. He has been mixing in the box for years and years and years, and he has had the most number one records ever. So it's another thing that you can see that it doesn't really matter. It's more like a taste thing. And as far as loudness goes, we used to go super loud. I just did a mix. It was a radio mix. They hired me for a radio mix. And with the radio mix, they wanted a completely different approach, and they gave me the master and mixed version that is out on the album. And that one was at -6 LUFS, which is incredibly loud, because all the streaming services are normalizing way less loud. Majority of the records that get mastered nowadays are like -9, -8. Don't go over that. So I was competing against a super loud master. First thing I did is I just brought it back to -8 LUFS. So I had a reference point for my mix without going, oh, it sounds way louder, so therefore it sounds better, which is not the case. So usually my references to clients are -8, -9. Then there's a website called, I think it's loudnesspenalty.com. So if you go to loudnesspenalty.com, you can actually upload your mix master, and it will give you back by how much the different streaming services are turning down your actual mix or master. So you will see Amazon, Spotify, Apple, how much they will turn it down, or if you have more headroom to push it up more. Because you got to realize that the more limited your mix is, when it gets turned down and then normalized again by the streaming services, it might turn out to be less loud compared to any of the other records. So you gotta always make sure that you stay within a pretty safe realm. So for majority of you guys, I would start off with -10 LUFS and then just see how that sounds and upload it to loudnesspenalty.com and see what actually happens with your audio as far as how much does it get turned down or turned up. Let's see what other questions I can still answer. Okay, as far as the monitoring level goes, Ergum asked me that question. I try to monitor on average around like 84 dB SPL. It's the speech level that we have. It's where our ear is most consistent frequency wise. And then what I do is every once in a while, I'll turn up the volume super loud to see how the music feels. And then, like I said before, I would turn it down almost all the way till it's barely audible, like kitchen level, as we would call it, and see how my vocals and the rest of the instruments sit without anything poking out. The other thing I do a lot too is turn it up loud, leave the room, go sit in the lobby or somewhere else, and just hear if anything sticks out coming from the room sound-wise. And if you hear that, you can address that and fix that in the mix. Another thing that I want to show you guys that I monitor on as well is this thing. So this is Audre.io, and it's a plugin. It costs $25. And you can stream music directly to your Audible devices. So if I open up the app on here, which is right here, you can see on the screen that it just said iPhone, and I can click on it and I can connect it. So now it's connecting to my iPhone and it's connected. So I can now stream my session to my iPhone and listen to what my mix is sounding like on small speakers. So that's an incredibly great tool. Brian asked me in regards to working with artists, how much input does the artist have on your final mix? The artist has 1000% input on how the final mix sounds. Not sure if you already were present when I first started the seminar. A mixer has to be very selfless, I need to say, sorry. What it is about is it's about the artist, it's about the music itself. So it's not about us as the mixer imprinting our stamp, so to speak, on the music. So it's all about like, what does the artist want with the record? What's the vision the artist has? So the artist is end-all be-all with how the mix is gonna sound. That's another great thing about what I just got asked is about monitoring. So for instance, every manufacturer says my speakers are designed to be flat. You know, these headphones are flat. And when it comes to the real world, it's completely not true. Every speaker, every headphone has a certain frequency curve. And what I want to do is I want to make sure that everything is tuned at all times. So what I hear in my headphones is the same way I'm going to hear it on my monitors. And then through that, I also know pretty sure how it's going to sound in the outside world, in the car, on the TV, whatsoever. So there's this manufacturer called SonarWorks, and they have a plugin called Reference. This is the fourth edition. And as you can see, these are my headphones. It's the Focal Listen Pro, and they have a profile for it. So this is what the headphone actually sounds like. If you look at it, that's the headphones response curve. And now is it how it's tuned. So as you can see, it's pretty much flat. So I know at least that from my headphones to any other device, this what I'm hearing on my headphones is how the music truly sounds. And I have the same way in the studio for my monitors. So it always sounds the same from one system to the next system, because I know this is tuned, this is how it's supposed to sound. I just want to hear the music. I don't want to hear the room. I don't want to hear the speakers, so to speak, or the headphones. Maria asks, when do you decide your mix is completed? I don't think we ever have a mix that's completely completed. I think we are always battling against a time clock. So usually what happens is I listen, I mix everything to me, for me, goes very much about intuition. So my first, after I've organized the session, color coded it, as you can see, my, you know, the Lil Wayne's vocals are darker blue. Jazz vocals are more like baby blue. My effect returns are green. My parallel is a darker blue. My bass is brown. My drums are red. My keyboards are purple. My special effect sounds are green. That way I can quickly see what is what. I organize everything in a fashionly manner for myself that I know what it is. So I play back, and once I'm playing it, I'm just, you know, seeing what is a great element in the mix, what I'm drawn to when I start working on there. Be it the drums, be it the vocals. Do that for about 4 hours, have like a first print that's pretty solid, and then I start kind of carving and fine tuning it. I'll do that for probably another 2 to 4 hours until there's a V1, in my opinion, and I'll send it out to the client. But at the end of the day, even when I hear this mix back, there's things that I would change now that I wouldn't have done back then. Or it's also a mood thing, like today I feel like this, so I'd like to use this compressor versus that compressor, or that type of EQ versus that type of EQ. It's very much in the moment. So to answer the question, there's not really any time that something is really done. I think that same thing goes for producers. I don't think a song is ever done production wise. I think you always will hear stuff you would have done different, stuff you would have added to it. So it's basically just something that you have to go like, I think this sounds great. I don't need to start overthinking it. It feels great. Let's send it out and tomorrow's another day. Then before I let you guys completely go, wanted to give you guys a little treat with Black Rooster Audio. It's the guys that do programming, or used to do programming coding for Plugin Alliance. We've been developing plugins. I got my signature series coming out fairly soon. This is the first time we actually rolled it out on Pro Tools. So we were not sure if it was going to run stable, but we're working on a series of plugins. So this is a compressor you know, we all have 20 million compressors in our DAW, but the beautiful thing about this compressor is there are certain things. There's, for instance, a low band EQ, high band EQ, and you have Q settings for it, so you can determine the slope of the EQ. You can link, if it's stereo, you can either do a complete stereo link of the two channels, or you can kind of have them interact independently compression-wise. And then the detector is where the biggest difference is going to be in. So it says right here, Hilbert. So what is Hilbert? So a Hilbert filter is basically a all band filter that uses phase shifting. So it shifts the phase of the audio in parallel that comes in and uses that detector. So you pretty much have a zero latency response when compressing versus, you know, any of the other types, peak or root mean square. So the cool thing is that even if you do tracking or anything, you can use the compressor without having any latency issues. And on top of that, you can get stuff to react extremely efficiently and quick. All the other features are pretty much similar. You know, you have your attack, your release, your threshold, the degree of knee you want to have, if you want to have it like gradually going as far as compression goes, or you want to get it steep and hitting hard, your ratio, your makeup. So this plugin is the first of four plugins that we've been developing over the past months. Should be available in, I think, a couple of months. We're really excited about that. And hopefully you guys will enjoy it as well. So that's a little treat for now of things that are coming. I'm going to answer a few more questions for the day. Stephanie asked if I've always used Pro Tools. Yes, but I've also in the past done mixes on Logic. And for a minute, I was using the Wendo Cubase's post-production software. But because of the standardization of audio, I've just come back to Pro Tools. Okay, Dan is asking if I use manual vocal writing before engaging a compressor. It differs. So for instance, vocals like these where it's already pretty much recorded properly, the engineer or the producer has already comped the vocals, as you can see, to like one vocal, done the vocal rights already, then there's not really any need. I can use slight compression to kind of even it out a bit more, to have it sit more solidly in the record. And from time to time, there's a track where there's some vocals jumping, so I would manually vocal write the vocal to be a bit more solid. And then as I do with all vocals, I'll send them to a main lead vocal buzz or main ad-lib buzz, and then I'll compress that slightly. Because the thing with compression is always pretty audible, and the more natural you can get is usually better for the ears, the most pleasing. So it's better to vocal write than to just have and hit heavy compression. It just squeezes sounds too much, and I'm not a fan of that sound. And I assume a lot of people are not happy with that sound either. So try to vocal write them before you do anything, add a little bit of compression to keep them more in the box and go from there. Don't go overboard with 20 compressors or whatever, because what happens is your sound becomes less and less. It just degrades, and your results will be way less than you expected. And then you start figuring out, why are none of these compressors doing the trick that I want to have? Vocal write your vocals. See a couple more questions. Kimonte, I hope I pronounce your name correct, asked me, what's your relationship like with the producers of the records? How could a producer network with help a mixer engineer? Relationship's always great with the producers, because at the end of the day, they produce the record. It just comes down to whether they are executive producing as well, because in that case, the executive producer has final say over everything. They have the global vision of what needs to happen. either together with the artist or by themselves. So it's very good to have a great relationship with them and constantly communicate with them, like communicate, figure out what they hear, what their vision is, make sure that you translate that vision in the mixes. And it's always good to build relationships with producers, because the best thing that can ever happen is you build a great relationship with a producer, means that now you have a career because you have a producer that will always send you the records. So whatever they produce and plays, you're going to be mixing it. And at the same end, on our end, I love producers because producers let us try things out that we normally would not do. For instance, like I told you the Ronnie J story, it's like I would never do that, or, you know, put certain processors on vocals or instruments that they were never meant to be made for, but because it's not meant made for it, it creates a unique sound. And a lot of times, like, wow, it just opens your eyes. It's like, this is really dope. Like, I would have never ever come up with that myself, but because the producer is using it in a non-traditional way, it now helps me be more creative and, you know, make records sound different and help the artist sound different than anybody else because we're doing things different. So that's always a two-way street. It's the relationships need to be there between the artist and the mixer and vice versa. Okay, somebody asked if, what if you think the mix is great, but the artist disagree? At the end of the day, like I said earlier, is you as a mixer are doing this for the art. You're doing this for the artist, you're doing this for the producer. So at the end of the day, if the artist disagrees, then the artist disagrees. There are situations where there needs to be a little bit of an education because people can get demo-itis, as we call it, which means the artist might have lived with a record for months and months, and they're so accustomed to the sound of that demo or rough, as we call it, that any slight change will throw them off and they will think it just sounds worse. That's when there needs to be an executive producer or the producer of the song that's like, hey, or even, you know, the record label that goes, you know, stop listening to everything, leave the record alone for a few days so that you have fresh ears. And then what you do is you basically compare the mix versus the rough. And then usually what happens is they start hearing like, oh, that it's right. The mix sounds like a mix. The demo or rough sounds like a demo or rough, especially comparing it to what's out there. So that's kind of how you can educate, you know, the client on not becoming too gung-ho on the demo-itis element of the record. Okay, let's answer one more question. Okay, somebody asked about networking. So the best thing to do, what I've seen that has always worked, is every artist or every producer they have their little clique, so to speak. So I'd say start out locally, find out who the local talent is, you know, who you think is the next big artist in your hometown, who's the next big producer in your hometown. Start networking with them and start building a unique sound with those people. And that way you can move yourself up career-wise versus, you know, everybody wants to work with the Chris Browns or the Rihannas. You know, it's better to start off with your group, because then, chase, it's something that Timbaland always used to say, is find the next talent versus chasing the talent that's already big. Because then what happens is you will be the one with the hit talent. It's pretty much the same thing that happened with X and The Camp. We pretty much came up with Ja, and through Ja, other opportunities, of course, started happening or started building out more for a lot of people, including myself. So it's another thing where it's like you grow organically with local to become worldly, if that makes sense. I think this concludes our seminar for now. Hope everybody enjoyed it. If you have any further questions, please don't hesitate to either go to my website, mixedbykoenheldens.com, hit the email button, check out the guys and girls from Yellowbrick. They're doing a great, great thing with education for various industries, as well as the partnerships that they have with NYU Tisch, Clive Davis School of Recorded Music. So a lot of information out there that you gain from there, both on the creative end, the technical end, the business end. Check them out as well. And I hope this was informative for you guys, that it helped you out. And I'm going to wish you guys a great day. And let's start being creative during this quarantine season. Let's make some hits. Thank you, guys.